Mike, how much training do you go through for that single mission?
We go through a lot of training, Harry. We were announced as a crew on Halloween of 2006 when Mike Griffin. Hello, everybody. By the way, everybody okay? Sorry. Harry, it's good to see you again. Thanks very much. Appreciate your interest in coming. We go through a lot of training. You saw the part in the pool. We spent a lot of time in the pool. For every hour we spacewalk, we spent about 18 hours in the water. So for one spacewalk, we practiced it about 18 times. And I said we were announced on Halloween of 2006 by Mr. Griffin, and we flew in May of 2009, so it was about 2.5 years. We had a couple delays. We were almost close to launch in October of 2008, and then there was another failure. Something broke on the telescope, and they pushed us back to May. But we had an awful lot of training in the pool, but also other things, practicing the rendezvous, the robot arm stuff, the inspections of the space shuttle. So it was probably out of that 2.5 years, if we gave 6 months, we kind of worked our way into it, and then for about 2 years, we were training pretty hard almost every day.
In all that training, did you ever actually practice breaking a piece of the Hubble and ripping it off in outer space?
No,
it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, no, not like that. But my wife and kids are here in Austin, but they're not here right now. They see enough of me apparently, and then to see Dad on that 3D is too much. But my wife will attest, Harry, that I break an awful lot of stuff at home. So I've had, and the thing that prepared me for that.
Yeah.
I grew up in New York in an Italian neighborhood, and we all lived near each other. My relatives, my Uncle Frank was right across the street, and I remember there was this one day I probably was about 12 or 13, and my Uncle Frank comes across the street all covered in oil, right, and he's talking to my father about something. And my father goes, come with me, maybe you'll learn something. We go down to the basement. My father grew up on a farm and then moved to around the city area. And he had this gigantic screwdriver that he had left over from the farm, biggest screwdriver I ever saw. And we go across the street, and he gives it to my Uncle Frank, and he hammers this screwdriver through the oil filter. Okay? And so now he's got some leverage on this thing. And I remember my Uncle Frank, full bit oil, grabbing a rag. I'm about 12 years old watching this. He starts yanking on the screwdriver. Mm-hmm. Harry, he starts saying stuff that I can't say here because this is a G-rated movie. But he's pulling on that thing, and finally gets the oil filter to break its torque and can remove the oil filter and change the oil. And that's what I was thinking of when I was up there. My Uncle Frank grabbing on the screwdriver to get the oil filter off. So I guess I've seen people do stuff like that, and I've broken us. But no, we had no idea. In fact, that was supposed to be a real easy task, getting that bolt off. We had 117 screws in there. Those were supposed to be the easiest, and it didn't work that way.
When something like that goes wrong, what's going through your head?
We had practice, as I said, many years for that.
Yeah.
Drew Foistel, the guy that we used to, my buddy Drew, and I, he was inside talking me through what was going outside. He and I by ourselves had practiced countless hours on a separate trainer that was outside of the pool. We'd go in on weekends, we'd stay late, whatever we needed to do, the workout. He and I are exactly what I was going to be doing, what he was going to tell me. And we had put all this time in because we were hopeful that this instrument might go on to find some planets that
absolutely
people are interested in. And so I really wanted everything to go well. And when that happened, I was in a nightmare.
Yeah.
Like you could not believe. I never felt as low as I felt at that time. I was just feeling awful. I cannot believe that this is going to happen. I would say it was the low point of my life, easily the low point of my professional life. And you're spacewalking at the same time. You got the Earth around you, and all this is kind of strange to be depressed while all that's going on.
And then from Earth, they say just break it off.
Yeah. That was the best solution I ever heard in my life. There was a time I remember I had to go and fetch these tools they were getting. They were trying to come. I knew they were just kind of brainstorming. They had me get vice grips, and that sounded okay. And then they had me get this bolt catcher thing. It started to sound a little bit weirder. And then he told me to get tape. We actually had tape tucked away somewhere in the outside of the space shuttle. I was ready for them to come with staples and glue. What about the glue? And I just couldn't believe it. And I remember looking up at Drew because I had to go to the front of the cabin while this was going on to get this stuff, and I could see him through the window. I didn't even want to look at him. I was so depressed. And I look up, and I can see Drew's face through the window. And I didn't want to look at him because I was so disappointed the way things were going. I look up at him, And he just started smiling at me and giving me a thumbs up. And we didn't want to say anything because people would hear us, but I could read his lips and he could read mine. And he's going, "We're going to be fine. We're going, okay, man, there's no problem." And I'm looking at him saying, "What Facebook are you watching?" He goes, "What are you worried about? We're going to be okay." And that made me feel better. But when I heard that solution came up, I knew we were going to be okay. And the engineer I'm giving credit to is a guy by the name of James Cooper, who they have a team of people around the world trying to help you out, and they had a model of that instrument. And he came up with the idea to just see if we could yank it off. And he can call me anytime, and I owe him whatever beverage he wants. I'll give him my credit card number. But I could not thank him and his group enough.
Cool. The science behind converting those images into what we saw, because that's easily some of the most jaw-dropping imagery I've ever seen.
Well, I can start with that. Well, it was a thrill to work on that. I've been looking at those Hubble images for years on the website.
Yeah, me
and
too.
Always wanted to marry them with the six-story high IMAX 3D canvas. And so we found a really wonderful pair of teams from the Hubble Space Telescope Institute in Baltimore. They're the guys that award the time to scientists and administer the website. And also the University of Illinois Supercomputing Center has another team led by Donna Cox. And so we formed a little triangle and planned these two long fly-through sequences. And that's all real data. There's not any special effects in there. That's all huge Hubble data set that you're seeing. The first one, Orion, do you remember how many pixels across it is? It's
bazillions
of pixels across the data set. So what you do is you go down to the University of Illinois. I never saw the banks of billions of computers, but they have a software program called Verdure. Maybe some of you have heard of it, which is a virtual director. And it basically lets you fly through this data. In other words, you can pick a keyframe where you want to start your flight, and then you can say, "Well, I want to go over here next. Let's see what that looks like." And you establish another frame, and the software interpolates the path. But it's all through the real data. And the reason we can see into Orion is, as the Leonardo, be still my heart, said, that the stellar winds blew the side off the nebula. So fortunately for Hubble, can see right in there and everything that's going on. So basically, that's the way that works.
It's truly remarkable to see it like that.
Pretty jaw-dropping, I think. I'm still getting goosebumps looking at it.
At what point do y'all step in to say, "This is a mission we want to be a part of, we want to document it, we want to show it in this format"? And to the to Mike, what's it like when you hear, "Oh, and by the way, in addition to all this technical stuff you have to do, you're also going to become an IMAX cameraman and documentarian"? What's that like for y'all?
Well, James, why don't you answer about deciding to go on the mission?
Well, we'd basically fly on everyone they'd let us fly on to begin with.
That's true.
It's got to be something pretty spectacular, I think. We've filmed about five or six of these things in space. We started with, Dream is Alive, about the shuttle, onto Blue Planet, which was a space film about Earth, then Destiny in Space, exploring the universe. Mission to Mir was about the Mir space station expeditions. And then finally, last one was our first 3D was the space station. So those were all pretty big landmarks in the NASA history. So Hubble has just been a tremendous boon to the scientific industry or scientific community. And it was a natural for us to be on because we had filmed the deploy with STS-31 in 1990, and then the first service mission on 61 in 93. So we had a backlog of some images that we could use with this. So
plus knowing he would be on this,
oh, yeah.
Who could resist?
Well, Mass, what's it like training with the IMAX equipment and operating with it? I assume you have to operate it underwater as well as in outer space. Is it much easier to use the camera in outer space versus the swimming pool?
Yeah, for the scenes you saw of the IMAX camera floating were filmed by Howard Hall and his team of underwater guys. And we did have a mock-up of the camera, Malacca meaning we had a camera, in the place where this camera would be. So while we were training, it was mainly the folks, it wasn't controlled from the outside, it was controlled from the inside. So what we would do is we would look at the shot we would be getting from that camera during our spacewalk training, and we had James and Toni come and join us in the control room, and they would say, all right, we want to start the scene here and end it here, and that would go right in our checklist. And the way we controlled the outdoor camera, meaning the one in the payload bay, was to start it with the personal computer at the right time and then stop it. Of course, we didn't want to waste any film. We only had 8 minutes of film for the outside payload bay camera sequences that you thought, so we would feel terrible if we forgot to turn the thing off. Can you imagine? I just found out, actually, that Toni said there's 1 minute and the thing cuts off automatically because they had an insurance policy against us for getting to turn the thing off. So we would turn the thing on and off, and it really wasn't that bad. But
we didn't trust you.
No, I don't. I wouldn't trust us.
It was the previous flights, yeah.
But to answer, you had asking earlier about, you know, our motivation or having this added as training too. Joan Grunswald came into our office and told us that Toni and her team and James were interested in trying to include our flight as part of an IMAX movie. And all of us realized the value of how fortunate we would be to be a part of that and to do whatever we could to make it successful. And the only sad thing I would say about traveling into space is when you see some of the things we see. When I see the Earth in its entirety, and it looks like heaven is the way I describe it. It is perfection. And when you see that and the chill goes through your body of what you're seeing, or you see thunderstorms over Australia at night, or you see whatever it is that the stars, whatever it is that we're seeing, and it's so beautiful. The frustrating thing is that I don't have my wife and my children, my friends, and all of you here with me watching it. Right? And it's like, how do I describe this? How do I tell them about this? And you can take pictures and movies and try to write stuff down, but nothing describes it like this movie does. Yeah. And we knew that that was a possibility, that we would be given the opportunity to be able to share it with everybody, the beauty that we see, in addition to the story, the education, of course. But for me, it was just the sheer experience of going that I knew if we did a good job like they were going to train us to do, that you know, we have something like this where people could all enjoy the experience we're lucky enough to have.
What's it like seeing these images this way for you? Because, I mean, you work to help make the gear give us this, but when finally the Hubble opens its eye and finally sees the stuff and then it gets converted into data that can be shown like this, you just have to feel proud as hell.
Well, I'm really glad I didn't bust it on him. You know, when I was thinking through some of my training, that when I was having that nightmare with that handrail, you know, I was thinking, what would the astronomy books say? Or what are they going to say? You know, my kids are going to go to school, and it's going to, you know, they're going to open up the astronomy section of the science book, and it's going to say, we wouldn't know if there's life on other planets. Mr. Massimino, the Star Trek. You know? So I'm really grateful that none of that happened. And maybe later I can tell you some stories of what almost happened. What's that?
As a result, people don't say, he made a mass out of it.
That's right. It would have been that way, right? You'd have to rename the movie The Destruction of Hubble in 3D. You
know? And at that point, nobody would ever
mass
use the word mess anymore.
That's right.
It would become mass.
Exactly.
You would change.
Right. That's right. So I was very grateful, really grateful that we didn't damage anything. We did our job, and you know, when you let the telescope go, you don't really. I mean, you know, everything's kind of hooked up. They can do like what they call an aliveness test. So basically, that they're, you know, the power. There's life going through the instrument, so to speak, electricity, and everything's flowing okay. But you don't really do a real functional check out of the telescope. You know, they start doing that weeks after. They really don't do that until after we're way gone and landed. So you really don't know for sure if everything is working until you see those first images. So I love those first images because I think that they're beautiful and their scientific value is great, but also because it's proof that, you know, all right, we did it. We don't have to worry about them looking after us for a warranty.
How much longer will we have Hubble up there?
5 to 10 years. Five at an absolute minimum, and hopefully much longer than that. And already since we finished the film, it has seen further back than They tell me at the Space Telescope Science Institute that the little galaxy you see when you get the furthest back in this movie, there's a pair of them, and they're called Fred and Wilma. And already, since the movie was finished, they have seen back another, I think, 3 billion light years. And Hubble, you know, is all the time raising and opening as many questions as it's answering things. And that's the really interesting part of it, because it's far from over, folks.
A film like this is just such stunning, great knowledge and propaganda for NASA to a certain degree. Will all the senators in Washington get to see this at the Space Institute there? And is the hope that it'll motivate them to see the value of this?
I, for one, sincerely hope so, because that has actually helped in the past, because it galvanizes the senators and the people on the Hill. They actually see and understand that NASA is doing wonderful things on orbit, and humans are doing wonderful things on orbit in concert with robotics, and that it's a meeting of two kinds of programs that will guarantee you success in the future. Mm-hmm. And the other flip side of that is that it is NASA's mandate, it's written right in their charter, to disseminate to the widest possible audience information about their activities. So that's what we're doing, and we hope that we inspire not only senators, but lots of young people as well to be interested in the future in astronomy or becoming astronauts or scientists of another kind.
I don't know, there's probably some things I'm supposed to be saying at this point, like write your congressman or vote a certain way or whatever, but I think I would ask people, you know, just look at what we're doing. It's really exciting. Someone mentioned to me, are you disappointed that, you know, the 2001 Space Odyssey and 2010 space station stuff, you know, that they showed in those movies, is not a reality.
Yeah, big wheel.
Yeah, big wheel. Oh, I said, well, never mind the big wheel. Look at what we got up there now. I mean, yeah, the space station's unbelievable. You know, we have a wonderful space station. It's an international effort. It involves countries from all over the world working together. I think there's a lot of wonderful things we're going to be doing in the future. And I would just ask people, you can write your congressman if you want, but just enjoy what is that's going on. And tell your kids about it. And if they're interested in math and science or anything at all to do with the space program, it's not just mathematicians and scientists and engineers and pilots. It's all kinds of folks. If you have an interest in the space program, there's a lot of really cool stuff going on. And if you're studying stuff in school, that's kind of boring because, you know, you might think it's boring to take some certain subjects. Maybe you don't like math or that, or you don't like the aspect of science. Don't worry about it. Do it anyway. Get through it, and then you're putting yourself in a position where you're eligible to start a career that's very exciting. So don't worry about so much what you get at. Worry about what you love. And do something that you love. And if you're interested in the space program, learn as much as you can and support it any way you can, whether that's watching, rooting, saying a prayer once in a while, whatever you can do, paying your taxes, all that helps.
You're told you have to train astronauts to have the cameraman's eye and to use the most technical, awesome camera known to man. How hard is it to teach these monkeys to shoot straight?
Some of them are easier than others. Sorry, Mike. Harry, maybe I should leave for a minute. It's the coolest job on the planet.
Yeah.
I'm second coolest. I'd like to be up there and fly with them, but it's really fun to do it. These guys, you can show them something and they've got it. You know, it's a piece of cake to train them. No matter what they say about the monkeys, these guys are a little bit better.
Just a little.
A little. But no, it's really a lot of fun for me. They train us as much as we train them. We know very little about what's going on in a mission. And from the first meeting that we have them, you know, a year, year and a half out from flight, we start learning from them what we should be filming. They teach us, you know, what's happening. We can't know anything about STIS and all this other stuff that they have to fix. unless they tell us. And then we start looking, okay, how's that going to work visually? And how's it going to work with what we have to shoot, where we have to shoot from, and the resources that we have. So it's a real, real team effort on everybody's part to develop our shot list, to get our shots down and replan. I mean, we have this whole, I don't know if you noticed the very first spacewalk, the bolt broke, okay, wouldn't come off. And it put the whole timeline, so we missed the whole IMAX shot there because that timeline slipped, but we replanned and we came back from it and managed to make it work. So it was, they're pretty quick studies. They're great guys to work with, and you know, if we could just teach them how not to break things when they go out, they'd be all right.
Toni, how did you decide which Hubble shots you wanted to bring us in this format? Like, what was it about, ooh, yeah, we have to go into Orion's Belt, we have to see this?
That's a great question, and the answer is it was really, really difficult because there are millions and millions of beautiful pictures. If anyone has been to the Hubble website, yeah, you could disappear in there for a month and not come out. No, the reason I chose Orion is that it's a feature in the night sky for a lot of people. Even if you don't know anything about astronomy, which I don't know much about astronomy going in, certainly have an education, but most people are familiar with Orion's Belt as a fixture in the night sky. So I wanted to explore something that you could actually see from Earth, where you had an idea that that is up there. And that doesn't work for all continents, but for a lot of us. So that was the driving force there. And then the end sequence where we leave the Milky Way, and I wanted to do a sequence about scale because it's so very, very hard to convey the sheer limitless size of everything. And that sequence was a very simple way of saying, okay, the Milky Way is a galaxy, and then that's one of a group of a dozen, and then you go to 1,000, and then you work your way up from there until you feel so totally insignificant. But that's what I really wanted to try to convey to really people of all ages, just how enormous it is. And it's almost impossible to do, but we thought we'd take a crack at it.
One thing I'd like to add is what's cool about Orion is you guys can go home tonight, it's nice and clear out, you can get out your binoculars, look up in the sky, and you can see that nebula we flew through binoculars.
No, I think
that's cool.
Just to follow up on the other images, mm-hmm. The ones at the end, before the fly-through from the Milky Way, those were the very first pictures back from the repaired telescope after Amass and the crew had finished. So those were the early release pictures that came back in September. That's why they were there.
Well, I'd like to definitely say thank you for, you know, repairing Hubble so that James Cameron could get us really close to Pandora. No.
You're welcome.
I'd shoot a heck of a lot more. Absolutely. I mean, the 8 minutes is just for, if you're interested, it's the film goes through the camera at 660 feet a minute. It's a mile of film. That's as much as we can possibly get into that canister, and you can't reload it. So, yes, the first answer is you would have a lot more coverage, but it's very, very hard. Well, you can't yet duplicate that kind of quality in the picture digitally. It's not nearly there yet.
Maybe you could talk a little bit about 3D and the experience of shooting stereoscopically, because in my experience, stereoscopic shooting is very technical. It takes a lot of calibration. So how do you preset a camera for
Presetting 3D for space. We keep it as simple as possible. The cameras, the 3D cameras we fly in space were purpose built for space flight. And one of the first things we decided was to take any intraocular changes out and take any convergence changes out. So the lens are parallel at a fixed interocular. So that's way too technical for most people, but you can't make them look like that and you can't bring them apart. So that takes a big load of the calculations out for the crew. And you can play around with the depth a little bit, but it keeps it within a comfortable range for most people. And so that was the whole plan, was just to keep it as simple as possible. I mean, these guys got enough to do without, you know, having to worry about convergence and all that stuff. And so, yeah.
I just want to say, I can't remember a time that I've watched a movie with the biggest, goofiest grin on my face.
Great!
Isn't that bad? No.
Can you just explain, I guess that the telescope is receiving data, but how is it that the Hubble, it seems like crane shots,
well, the telescope itself isn't doing that. It just has this huge, very, very, very high resolution data set of the whole thing. So we are manipulating that data with the Verder software. So that's
the astronomers at the Hubble Space Telescope Institute also know where these planets or the stars are in relationship to one another. So they have XYZ coordinates on the stars from all the data that they've received. So they can take, when you've got three coordinates, you can create 3D and you can fly around any object. So we're taking real data and then flying through it in a 3D space is basically what's happening with that. And then the same with the clouds. They know that there's the dip in it because they've done spectrographic analysis of it. So the data's there. It's all real. It's just flown through with the computer.
It took the entire Christmas holidays just to render that one sequence.
Took
every computer in the National Center for Supercomputing Applications to do that over the Christmas holidays. And we only lucked out because none of the professors were using it for other apps during the Christmas holidays.
Would you characterize the way that this was composited? Is it sort of a bunch of 2D images sort of composited into a 3D volume? Is that how you guys approach actually composing the imagery?
It's not really a bunch. It's one single. Huge single
mosaic.
That's huge. It's really hard to describe. I mean, you could keep blowing that picture up until it filled this.
Yeah, let me tell you, if I took a 2D image right here of everybody, and then I got my tape measure out and I measured to each person individually in this room, I could fly around it basically. You know, I don't have their faces, but I could fly around it in 3D space. Okay, now with the star, it's a round, glowy object. So you don't have, it doesn't have a face, it doesn't have a front and a back. So you can fly around that and still have the same data pretty much. So that's why you can take a 2D image and make that measurement and convert it to 3D.
When you became an astronaut, pretty much think
you'd
be a pretty
worthy
person to begin with.
I don't know about that.
Just
one.
Just one. MIT, I think.
Yeah, I applied four times. I started applying when I was in grad school, got rejected. Second time I applied, I had to wait 2 years. And they select about 25 or so of us. They're selecting less the last couple of years, but hopefully it'll ramp up again. But it was my first year I applied, not just a letter saying sorry. And then 2 years later, I think I got the same letter. They changed the date, no. And 2 years after that, I applied again, got an interview, so they got to know me, and then they said no. And I applied again. One interesting thing was in between time, first and second interview, there was a guy who interviewed as well, I went to teach at Georgia Tech as a professor, and there was another guy that I interviewed in that same group that I did, and I won't tell you the guy's name, But he was telling, I go, so you're going to apply again? He goes, nah, you know, I tried it once. I went through the whole interview, and I don't want to have to go through it again. I figured they didn't want me. They're not going to take me. And I'm there saying, that's great, because this guy was a lot smarter than I was. I was like, oh, that's good. Yeah, you shouldn't try again. If I don't want to go through that either. Bang. So I got selected the next time. But there are other, Don Pettit, who's been on the space station, flew about a year ago or so, and is going to be flying again on a long-duration mission to the space station, interviewed 5 times. And this guy interviewed, like, you know, 1 year, then interviewed the next time 2 years later, got skipped the next time, they didn't want to see him, got skipped again, they didn't want to see him, interviewed again after that, skipped another, so like, he just kept trying, and they finally took him after, I don't know, like 18 years of trying, no joke. He was very early, very young. He was like in his late 20s, I think, when he first started interviewing. But they finally took him when he was in his early 40s, so yeah, sticking to it is really important.
How did you select Leonardo DiCaprio to be your narrator? That
I have to credit my boss, Greg Foster, at IMAX in Santa Monica. He's chairman of IMAX Film and Entertainment, and he has a lot of great Hollywood connections. And also Warner Brothers, our sponsor, very important player in all of this, because I wouldn't have got to make the film without the help of Warner Brothers. And so between Greg and Dan Feldman at Warner Brothers, that's how Leonardo came on board. And it's just very interesting. He said, you know, he grew up in East LA, and as a little kid, his parents took him to the California Science Museum, and he had seen all of our films, and was a big fan. So that helps you going in. And also he, as you know, is a committed environmentalist. So he brought that in with him into the film. And I think it was a really good perspective to have. It was just a pleasure working with him. It was great, you can tell. Hardly enjoyed it at all.
Well, thank y'all for coming. And
thank you.
Bless y'all for the work that y'all did.
Thank you.